song. It's like super, super political, you know? It's like kind of a Vietnam, post-Vietnam era kind of song about, you know, the soldiers and people who went off and got maimed and killed or psychologically damaged, and then he like made it into like a pop song. It's crazy. But yeah, I started collecting records when I was a young, probably like around 10 or 11 when I lived in Rhode Island. I had some stepbrothers that were into like the punk and hardcore scene, and I started getting exposed to that really early on in my life, like around 10, 9, 10, 11. So I was going to all ages shows pretty young with them and with some other friends, and I started buying like 7-inches that, you know, at these shows with these punk bands, these hardcore bands. Or I'd buy like their full length if they had one, which most people didn't at the time. They were just like, you know, crusty hardcore bands that would press like a few hundred records, whatever, you know, money they had, they would scrape together. They'd silk screen their own, like, you know, covers, and I just loved them. And they usually had like a, you know, like a photocopied poster or like, you know, some kind of supplemental thing that came with it. And I started collecting that stuff, and that stuff really meant something to me. And then I was doing mail order back then. You know, this is in like the early mid '80s, so I'd mail order from Discord or from SST, and like, you know, all these record labels, Touch and Go, and you know, I get in the mail, you get this like thing, and the record would come, and there'd be a poster in there, and there'd be like another like little catalog to order stuff, and they'd always throw a sticker in. It was really special. It was cool. It felt like you were a part of something, and back then you kind of had to know. You know, there's no way of really knowing about this stuff unless you got exposed to it firsthand or someone else like introduced you to it. So as friends were collecting records, we'd go hang out at each other's house and like play music, and we'd make tapes, and then we'd go skate ramps, play the tapes at the ramps, and then, you know, of course tapes came out, but still, like, vinyl was something that we all wanted because it usually came with some other stuff.
So that's amazing.
Yeah, so I mean, that was the early days, but then like what was interesting is I collected a lot of that music, and I had a shit ton of records. I had a pretty big collection of mostly punk, hardcore, post-punk stuff, new wave. Like, I had a lot of that stuff. And in my like late 20s, I was going to college, going to grad school, got a teaching job, and was like living in the Middle East for a little while. And I was moving around like every 2 years. I was in a different place, and my mother needed to move. And I had a ton of it, and I had to do something with it. And I remember like just being like, I gotta get rid of this. I can't deal with it anymore. So I sold most of it, pretty much all of it.
What?
Yeah. There was no regret at the time, but like a few years later, I fell into like a little pit of depression. I mean, not that I would go and like throw on like the Subhumans or the Meat Men or like, you know, like Void or anything like that, you know, on a regular basis to listen to it. But that stuff's worth a lot of money, and it kind of like threw my childhood away in a way, you know. And it's, that kind of bums me out a little bit when I think about it. I get a little sad about it, but it kind of, that moment where I realized what I did kind of got me excited again about, you know, collecting records. And but I was more interested in collecting stuff that was kind of like the grown-up version of that. And like, I grew up in my grandparents' house pretty much in Rhode Island. They kind of took care of me. They were like my daycare. My grandfather was super passionate about jazz. A pretty big collection of records. He had 78s like that filled half of his, you know, little workshop up in his basement. You know, just like boxes of 78s, which is like one song per side. But they, you know, he loved music. Like, he just absolutely appreciated and loved jazz, and he really loved the big band era and swing. He loved Artie Shaw. He loved Louis Armstrong. Like, that was really like his true love. But then I think later on he started getting into the smoothness and the sort of like the softness of a lot of the samba and the bossa nova stuff that was creeping into jazz. He wasn't a big fan of like hard bop jazz, like the kind of like New York style jazz and like scaling and stuff. He always said, "Oh, I can't really. Oh, I don't love it. I don't like it when they just go off on these crazy scales." He's like, "I want more of like a rhythm, you know, that I can stick to." Like, I remember him telling me that. There's so much, man. This song is like one of my favorite jazz songs ever, by Horace Silver. It's a song from my father, but it's a cover by Groove Holmes. I love this too. I love keeping, when I find records like this, I love keeping this shit on there.
So funny. I mean, it's like the Masterpiece series. This is like a reissue, but it was probably a reissue in the 80s. Yeah, because it was on Pacific Jazz, and then it's on Prestige here. You can tell, like, when there's, like, barcodes, usually that means it was, like, you know, pressed or reissued in the 80s or 90s. But I love, I mean, this is hilarious. Six, you know, $7. Then it's marked down to $5.49. I'd buy that for $5.49. But this song is incredible, and the reason why I love it so much is because this is, like, where you hear the bossa nova beat, like, coming in and influencing, like, hard bop jazz, and this guy is like a, you know, Groove Holmes is like a funk jazz sort of transition musician, art, you know, artist. So this song is, it's kind of slowed down and super funky. It's like perfect song for a sample. Guys were taking this thing that people thought about as a church instrument, like what you heard in church, they brought it into jazz and made it funky as hell. Like it became like the funky instrument, not like the you know, kind of stiff, you know, instrument that came from church. You know, it's kind of radical when you think about it. Started learning more about Brazilian, like funk and bossa nova and samba, and started learning the history of Brazilian music, and through reading about it, like whatever I could get. I remember going to the library at Chapel Hill and like getting a book on bossa nova and reading about it and tripping out and like oh my god, this is such an incredible genre of music. And then going and finding the movie Black Orpheus, which is this like beautiful movie that was made by this Italian director in Brazil. And it's like this, you know, this love story like about like the poor guy and the, you know, there's like two different, like, you know, people that come from two different parts of society. You know, it's beautiful, and tragic, and, you know, like a very like romantic movie, and like watching that and listening to that soundtrack. And it's like, and you just kind of, like, I'm that kind of person that once I get into something, I just want to keep digging and go deeper and deeper. But again, 90s, not a lot of information on the internet, not a lot of information that you can just go and read. You had to like really, really dig and find these people that like had a, you know, like a knowledge of this stuff.
When I moved to New York, I was obsessed with it at that point. In between moving from Richmond to New York, I went and I taught at a branch campus for VCU in Qatar in the Middle East. So when I went there, they had nothing to do other than like, you know, teach and make art and ride my bike, and it was pretty, you know, some like very conservative Muslim country. So they had like crazy like record stores, but they were only CDs. So I would go and, you know, and buy CDs. It was like 2000, year 2000. So I'm in there one day in this record shop. It's like an amazing record store, piles of music, and it was like music from all over the world, which was cool. It wasn't just like, you know, this like myopic kind of thing like we were getting here. It's like this pretty incredible landscape of music. So I'm in there buying weird Turkish music and, you know, just trying to learn, just like, randomly buy something like, that cover looks good, I'll buy that, you know. And I'm looking at this like rack of CDs, and there's this big Brazilian section, and I was like, oh shit. And I went over there, and there's Chimaya, and there's Caetano Veloso, and there's like these other weird compilations, and there's Elis Regina, and like, and I'm like, whoa, what's this? So then I started buying CDs and started learning about these guys. And then, you know, some of these comps were insane. And, you know, like Hermeto Pascoal, like all these people who are like, you know, like geniuses, brilliant, like super, super creative people. So then I came to New York. I'm like, okay, I'm in New York, I'm going to find this stuff. Nope, not finding it. Going to record stores, not finding it. Until my finally, this one day I was at my friend Doug's little record shop that was actually beneath our old shop. Metropolitan. He's called the Record Grouch. He's now in Greenpoint. But for about a year, he had a little space in this basement of this old crusty building. I was down there hanging out with him one day. He's like, have you ever been over to that new spot that this Brazilian guy just opened called Tropicália and Furs? And I was like, no, what the hell is that? He goes, yeah, it just opened. It's amazing. It's on Second Avenue, like Fifth Street. I'm like, what? No, fuck, are you kidding? He's like, you gotta go over there, man. Like, that, you're gonna find everything you want. Because I'd always be like trying to find Brazilian stuff, and he's like, dude, it just doesn't exist, you know. So I went over and I met Joel Stones. Yeah, and then first time I went in, there's Joel with his like saintly like halo afro, like Brazilian afro, like his big glasses on and big smile. Hey man, walk in, you know, just me and him. And I'm like, how's it going? I start talking to him, and I'm like, oh my god, I'm like a kid in a candy store. I'm like flipping through stuff. I'm like whoa, and I start pulling things. He's like, you like Brazilian music? I'm like, oh my god, man, like this is incredible. This is like the store I've always wanted. He goes, oh, this stuff? He's like, hold on, I'm gonna show you some shit. And he walks back and he pulls out a stack of records and he starts playing new stuff. And I'm like, I want that. And then he goes, and then I'm in there for like an hour and a half, 2 hours, 3 hours pass. He goes next door to the wine store. He gets a bottle of wine. We start drinking wine. He gets another bottle of wine. I'm in there for like 6-7 hours. I'm like blown away. I'm drunk. I just spent like $800 on records. And I'm like, I walk out of that place like, what did I just do? But that was a minute, man. I was like, this is like, this guy. It was like, it became like immediately like we were like fast friends. And but we've become really close over the years. That was like probably 12 years ago, maybe more, maybe like 14 years ago. But that guy is a genius. So Joel kind of cracked the door open for me. Now it's like, and I've been collecting from him for about that many years. And we have pop-ups here with him. But yeah, music is like this like guiding force in my life, you know. So yeah.